Hello, everybody, and welcome to our Kim's Upholstery Live, brought to you by Kim's Upholstery. Sorry, I dropped my gun right as we went on camera. Each week, we share with you a different upholstery process from start to finish. Sometimes we complete a whole project in one episode, and other times it takes several weeks. So this week, we're continuing on these chalk-painted chair frames that I did. So we actually painted this one online live, and I've got the one, I don't know if you can see over on the side here, in the turquoisey color that I also painted off camera. And again, we're using this fun fabric from Spoonflower, which was created by my friend Kristen Nicholas. So I purchased this on Spoonflower to do on these projects because I really loved the bright colors. So as you come in, we invite you to go ahead and say hello. Let us know where you're viewing from. And if you're working on an upholstery project, I'd love to hear what you're doing. And maybe even later you can post pictures and share your project with us. Also, while we're working, I encourage you to go ahead and ask questions. Bill does monitor the comments during the live episodes here. So sometimes I am able to answer them during the live, and other times we may miss a question and I have to go back and answer it later. But as you know, feel free to ask questions about what I'm working on, or if you have something you're working on that you have a question on, I'd love to help you with that as well. So again, go ahead, say hello, let us know you're there. Give us a thumbs up if the lighting and the sound is all good for you today, because I think it's good at our end. And let me go ahead and pick up my staple gun here. So I use a Fasco long nose staple gun for my projects. I like the long nose guns better because I can get into all those areas that you can't always get into with a short nose. So that was what I dropped on the floor. And I tell you, these babies work really well because I have dropped them 100 times, well, probably more like 1,000 times by now. And I think that's one of the first guns we ever bought. And so that's about 22 years ago. And it still works. So no matter how much I drop it, it keeps on stapling. So again, who's out there saying hello, Bill? Yeah, anybody? And also, while you're waiting for me to get started here, if you could go ahead and click that share button, we'd love it if you do that and share what we do with your friends out there on Facebook and YouTube. Hello, Beth, thanks for joining us. And Natalia, and Bonnie, and Annette, and Janice, and Jackie. How's that grandbaby doing, Jackie? She was adorable. So, okay, last week we started with the seat. We had already gotten the springs done. These were zigzag springs. I put the burlap on. We did the, I think it was 3/4 inch edge roll that we had put onto the chair. And then we used, I believe, 6 layers of cotton and 1 layer of Dacron to pad the seat. And we got the fabric attached in the center, in the front and back. And then we made our first cut at the front arm post here where it comes down on the side of the chair. Let me turn that so you can see. So we made a cut to get around this post, and we were at the point where we were just about ready to make the cut around the back post. So that's where we are today, is getting that cut going. Now we had marked it a little bit last week, so I am just going to double check my marks that I made here. And what I did was push it down as far as I could get it into the deck area and made the mark so that I know where my cut was, width was, and how far I'm going into the fabric. And go ahead and stick that down there. And the tool I'm using to do this is called a tucking tool. And this is an Osborne tucking tool, and it really saves your fingers when you're working on areas like this, or when you're doing like a fully upholstered chair with arms and everything and you're trying to tuck the fabric in there. It really comes in handy for all that. So, all right, so if I pull this down, come around, just seeing where I need my fabric to go, making sure my marks are good. And I think we're good, so we're ready to go ahead and make that cut. So again, that's what the tucking tool looks like. So it's just got a long flat metal area and then the wooden handle to hang on to. And it really does save your hands. If you've ever worked on an upholstery project and you're tucking your fingers into those tight spots, when the time you're done with your project, your fingers are tender. And this will help you with that. So let me go ahead and stick it back up there for the moment. And are we ready to make that first cut? Actually, in this case, the second cut. First cut for today. I'm going to bring this over closer to the edge of the pedestal that I have it sitting on here. And I'm going to cut, which camera are they on, Bill? Still over there? I'm going to cut in from the edge of the fabric and go in between the marks that I made and then make my V cut. Now, many of you may have watched our online classes video, Making the Cuts, where we show all these different cuts on a bare frame so you can really see where your target is when you're making these cuts and you're not just like blindly pushing the fabric down. kimsupholstery.com, so you can really see what we're headed for. And there you can see that cut that I've made. Right here is the little V. And we're going to tuck our little tail. Voila, look at that. Perfect first time, which is exactly what we want with this kind of cut, because if it wasn't, we'd be putting on new fabric. Although I shouldn't say that yet, because we haven't made the second one, right? So if I spin this around, here you can see by the way I made my cuts, I now have some excess fabric to fold back. It's hard to get my hands out of your way, and I have a finished edge against my upright posts. So let's go ahead and get this back one stapled down. Put my fold there. And I'm going to get one staple up close to the edge of the back post here. I just got to feel where that ledge of the frame is. Oh, there's a staple there from the past upholstery. That's what's in my way. So let me go ahead and pull that out. No matter how many staples you pull, there's always one that you miss. And at this point, you want to be careful so you don't gouge your paint job too much or wreck your fabric pulling out staples from the previous. And I'm using these wire cutters. These happen to be sharper ones, but dull wire cutters. If you can find secondhand wire cutters at a flea market or something, they're the best because then they're dulled so they don't cut your staples. All right, so I get those out of the way. Now let's try that again. Folding the fabric under, keeping that folded edge right there. Now we'll come to the front. So what projects is everybody working on? It's outdoor cushion season, I bet, in a lot of areas. We have finally hit the warm weather here. Although my son got married on Sunday, and we didn't have warm weather for his wedding, unfortunately. It was partially outdoors. It was kind of in a pavilion that had open walls, and it was only in the 50s, so we were a little bit chilly. Alright, so I just put one staple there to get that held. And now I want to see, because before, if you remember from last week, we got a few staples in here to hold everything. I had a couple staples that I did pull out because I knew I was going to need to shift this. And you can see when I'm pulling this down, I'm ending up causing a fold over here. So I am going to have to pull this staple. And you just end up wiggling this stuff in and easing it into the area you're stapling. And I can feel that edge with the end of my staple gun, so I know where the edge of the wood is, hopefully. There you get that staple loosened, so I can, whoops, turn the pullers around. And now I think that will be all. Nah, maybe not. I might have to take out one more. Alright, for some reason my gun is not wanting to fire. Probably because I dropped it, right?
Yeah.
I finally broke it. It's firing, just it didn't fire the first couple times though. Alright, I think I'm going to end up having to come back a little bit. So let me pop that last staple we put in there, or last two maybe. And it's just figuring out where you need to work the excess in to avoid having any wrinkles or puckers. And because they're sharp, they're just cutting my staples. And don't keep your mouth open while you're doing this, because that one just hit me right in the lip. Could have swallowed it. Does anybody got any questions yet, Bill, or sharing what they're working on?
Yeah.
Now, oftentimes, I know that when you're new to upholstery, it feels like you take out as many staples as you put in, and sometimes that is the case. It's just the nature of the beast. There. See if I got that all out. One little piece under there. And sometimes if you can't get them out, you can just cut them off and pound them in if you need to. All right, so let's wiggle that. Here we go, that's looking. There we go, so now I've worked that all in. There, so now I've worked in all the fullness, so I don't have to worry about any extra fullness. Now I can fill it in. I don't always fill it in before, because like I said, you have to make adjustments, and you don't want to have to pull out any more staples than necessary. So now we have that first side completely done. So let's go back to the front here. So we started in the center, we worked towards our first corner, we made our fold there. Before we made that fold though, we did make the cut here, got these attached, and now we're stapled. So this whole chair is stapled from the center over towards me. So let's see, it looks like we've got some comments. Joanne, hello Joanne, says she's working on 8 dining room chairs. If you're like me, Joanne, it's like after the second one, you're like, okay, when does this project end? Although dining room chairs aren't too bad because there's not a lot to most of them. Bonnie says they are so pretty, Kim. Thanks, Bonnie. And Sun Sun says amazing colors. Hello, and DG is joined. Hello, DG and Bethany. And Lynn, hi, she says hi to Kim and Bill. Just finished my first project after hand surgery. It was a small wing chair. Hope your hand's healing well. I know I had hand surgery a few years back and it does take a while to get back to your strength. Hello, Jana and Rhonda, thanks for joining. Rhonda from Colorado. And whoops, something popped there. Juvette, from Lindo Trabajo. I'm not sure where that is, but it sounds like it's a long ways away. And hello, Crystal. Thanks for joining us. And Tony and Peggy from Virginia. And Rhonda says, I am wrestling with this mid-century chair. It feels like I'm fighting an elephant. I know that feeling. You have those pieces sometimes. And hello, Jeannie Freeze. How are you? She's actually right here in New England. She's in New Hampshire. And hello, Ronnie. Bonnie says, I'm working on the chair. Whoops. Working on the chair you helped me with this morning. So far, so good. Yeah, that was quite a find to find that detailing underneath the fabric that you took off. And hello, Angela. She says, I'm learning upholstery and English with your videos. Thank you very much. You are welcome. I don't know how I'm a good English teacher, but hey. And hello, Diana. Thanks for joining. Diana's getting ready to head out on vacation here in another week, I think. And Crystal says she's finishing up slipcovers. I did see the post of your slipcovers earlier this morning, Crystal. Those are really nice, the big white sofa and chair that you've got. And Carla from Tennessee, hello. And Kristen watching from Ontario, Canada. Hello, Kristen. Actually, Bonnie's from Canada, too. All right, so now let's go make the next cut. How many of you love making cuts? Thumbs up. Thumbs up if you don't like making cuts. I think that's kind of like a pain point for most people. It's like it's so scary because you get all this work into it, and if you mess up one of your cuts, you're starting over, which is not always fun. Okay, so on YouTube, we have Susan Hartman from Annapolis, Maryland. I hope you weren't in the area that all the flooding was happening, Susan. And Tamara, hello Tamara, thanks for coming today. And Mary P, I found you this time. I'm working on a rush sheet chair. Nothing better than a natural rush in the morning and hanging out with Kim and Bill in the afternoon. Well, I hope you'll join us this afternoon for the Q&A too, Mary, because I know you were trying to do that, but I think it was last week and missed us. Okay, pencil. Where's my pencil? So I am going to go ahead and mark the edge of my front arm post here. Let's just turn the chair. There's my pencil over there. Almost knocked my gun down again. And what did I do with my tucking tool? I put it away. Are you like me when you put your tools away, you can't find them? If they're out and about, I can find them all over the place, but when I put them away, I'm like, where'd they go? And I'm just watching to make sure I've got the fabric nice and smooth here without pulling it too tight down there. I think we got it. Sometimes you feel like you need three hands, too. Now, actually, Diana, who is on here watching, is the one that introduced me to this tool in one of my workshops. I always thought, who needs a tucking tool? You can just push the fabric down. It's a waste of money. But then trying hers in the class, I was like, I need a tucking tool. Now I know why you need them. All right, so I've made my marks for my cuts. One thing I always like to do, students don't appreciate it too much though, when someone's in my class and they're making their cuts, I go, and they're like, don't do that to me. It's funny for a minute. All right, there you go. So there we go with our next cut. Let me spread that open so you can see. Oops. I spread it open just as Bill switched cameras. So there's my V, and this was my straight cut in. And again, I just tucked my point. Pull it down around. Get a staple on this side. And come over here. Just gonna get one staple here on the back side of the arm post. And I'm going to make that a temporary staple just in case I have to shift a little bit further to fold that once I make the back cut. And then we'll go ahead and make another, put another temporary staple in towards the center of the side here. Just making sure I'm in the right area on the wood. Now we can come back before we make that back cut and we can finish this front corner. Actually, let me look at how this one landed over on the other side. Okay, that's a little high, so I think I need to pop that back out. The hardest thing is getting the second side to look like the first side. And I've also seen, like in my workshops, where students want to go ahead, they've got this first one the way they like it, and they want to go ahead and cut all this off. But the danger of doing that is when you do your second side, if you can't get it to look like your first side and you like the second side better, now you can't change this if you've cut it all off. So if you just leave it like that, let yourself walk away from it. When you do this one, then you've got the ability to go back and change the first corner if you like your second side better. And the first time that happens to you, then you'll stop cutting everything off. But everybody wants to cut everything down right away. And you're better off not to. I'm still loving the color of this chair frame. All right, so pull this a little bit more, which means this, so as I pull here, I don't know if you can see this on camera, I'm causing a pucker here, which tells me I also need to remove that staple. But I'm gonna go ahead and get a temporary one over here just to, there's the edge of the wood, there it is. Here we go, I got it loose enough I think that I can catch it now. And then I'll turn this back where you guys can see a little better, but right now I need to angle it towards me.
You know where that little green pad is we have?
Oh, my knee pad? No, but you know what, if you can throw me a mat, it would be fine. He's looking for the pad that I usually have underneath my knees. It's probably in the other room somewhere, Bill, I don't know. Thank you. Yeah, kneeling on a cement floor after a while does hurt, so we usually try to have something under my knees. All right, so there we go, that's better now. I think this one's in the wrong place. So that temporary staple I had in there, I put over so far that I can't get my fold right. Come on, staple. Still not quite the same. There we go. I think I got it now. And you've heard me say 100 times, let the fabric tell you what it wants to do. And if you try to force it, it doesn't always work right and look good. So there, now I think my corners are very similar. So we're gonna go ahead and finish this up on the front. And then my double welt will come around the bottom edge once we're all done. So now I'm comfortable just coming right over from the center and heading to that corner. There. So now we have the whole front of our chair done and we're ready to go ahead down the side and make that last cut in the back area. So while I'm getting ready to make this cut, if you haven't already shared, go ahead and hit that share button for us. And let me untangle my gun so I can spin my chair without my gun wrapping around the pedestal. And I'm behind, I tell you, from doing this wedding this weekend, I've got myself behind. I have not gotten our Greenfield workshop up on the website yet, which I'm trying to get up by June 1st. And because I mentioned it last week on the live, I already have two people that have emailed me wanting to attend, so I need to get it up there. So that will be October, was it 19th through the 21st of October that we're going to have that one here. How many of you have a hard time keeping up with your working on your client's business and working on the business of the business? It's always a juggling act. With the workshops too, I always playing with you guys online and chatting with you is fun, but it's all a lot of fun in the workshops when everybody is here because I meet a lot of you that I've never met in person that I've only met online. And then we usually go out to dinner together and the conversations get really fun, sometimes totally off the upholstery topic, obviously, but we have a lot of fun when we go out to dinner, which we typically do every night after class. So, all right, so I've got double check over here. So what I do is make my little marks and then I kind of play with the fabric to see if it's going to give me enough of what I need, and it seems like it is, because you want to have that excess fabric. You do not want a raw edge against the frame of your chair, which would not be fun. Actually, from this angle, let me lower the pedestal a little bit, because I'm having a hard time getting down as low as I need to. Hello, Joan! She's from Connecticut, so she's right here in New England. I'm ducking because I have to see the monitor. I'm working on matching chairs, working on the matching chair to the one I did with you in the workshop back in October. Sorry about the previous emojis, that was an accident. I know, don't you love it when you hit the wrong emoji and then you're like, you can change it though. I did find that out the other day. But you'll have to share a picture of that chair when you get it done, Joan. Actually, Joan just had a great workshop with Donna Cash in Maine this past week. It was this past week, right? Where she hosted a pillow class. That looked like you guys had a lot of fun and some beautiful pillows. All right, now let me lock it because it's turning. And from the back, it looked like I was in the right place, but the front, I'm just questioning that, so I'm double checking. Nope, I think we are good. It's better to cut once and check two or three times. It still does not seem right. Let me just double check that. It feels like it's pulling it. Nope, it is. Okay. Better to check, like I said. You just don't want it to be wrong. So the fabric was telling me, check again. So how many of you understand letting the fabric talk to you and have experienced that? Thumbs up or smiley faces or hearts to say that you have, that you've experienced letting the fabric talk to you. And when it tells you, the worst part is if you don't listen to it, I'm just gonna raise the pedestal up here if I can find it, is when you don't listen to it and then afterwards you make the cut or whatever and you realize the fabric was telling me it didn't want it there. And now you gotta start over. All right, fold underneath. And I'm also constantly watching the grain of the fabric as I'm working too. Some fabrics it's harder to see the grain than others. This fabric actually is a linen canvas from Spoonflower, and the grain is pretty easily seen when you're up close like I am. Do you also find, I'm sure you do, when you're working on a project, one side goes easier than the other? And I think it has to do with the left-handed, right-handedness, where, like right now, my left hand is awkward because it's against the post, where over here, when I was folding it with my left hand, I had plenty of room. So, there, so you can see better. But so when I'm folding it here, it's like I want to come this way, but I can't because my hand's in the way. So you just got to find a different way to hang on to manipulate it. It's almost like you need a left-handed and a right-handed upholsterer to work together, and they each do the opposite side of the chair. Wouldn't that be fun? There's the edge, there it is. This chair has, or fabric rather, has so many different colors. That staple just jumped back. There must have been something underneath it. It has this turquoisey blue, which does not look, or tealy blue, which I know on the camera this blue looks like it's really blue, but it's really more of a teal in person. And it's got this fun green, and it's got a red, and it's got the pink and the purple, and then it's got two different shades of yellow. It's got a really light yellow and then kind of a deeper yellow. It's really fun because you could do a lot of different things in a room with this piece. Which Bill is still trying to figure out which room I'm going to do over. You'll have to wait and see. I don't even know yet. I'm thinking the dining room though. Okay, so now I have got the back is pretty well stapled all the way across. And now we need to work on these areas here in the front. Or not in the front, on the side, sorry about that. Trying to see if I need to fold that a little deeper, or I think we're gonna need to do both. I think I'm gonna have to remove that staple, fold that a little deeper, and I'm also gonna have to remove this staple and push some of this excess towards the front. But I also, at this point, wanna pay attention to the curve I'm creating so that I've got the same look and feel on both sides. I think that's good. Okay, that way I know I can get out easily, so let's go ahead and check this way. Some areas it's harder to feel this ledge than others. Oops, there's a staple into there. And I might have to pop this front one to get a little bit deeper fold there too. Yeah, I don't know if you can see it, but I've got just a little bit of excess fabric right. It's right in here in the green. It's probably really hard to see on camera. So I'm gonna pop this one staple and then just fold that a little bit deeper and we should be fine. You always want to think about where you want the fullness to end if you have any to deal with, because you don't want to work this way and have your fullness end in the middle. Now you got to take all those staples out. There we go. It seems like common sense, but when you're working, it's easy to kind of like just get going and not think of those things. All right, this one staple I can tell needs to be removed. Whoop. Alright, now I'm going to pop that first staple back out, fold that last little bit, and then this part will be done and we're ready to do the back. So let's see, we've got Mary from Alabama. Hello, thanks for joining us. Katrina says, love the fabric. I'm in Scotland and love doing upholstery. That's awesome. Susan Safakis is here. Hello, Susan and Nancy. Thanks for joining us. And no, Ragnay, I did not get to paint the pink door yet. We finally got some decent weather, so I need somebody to take Bill away for a day, and then I can paint the door when he's not here. Peggy says, although he heard me, right? Peggy says, I love the chair. Oops, gonna move my head for this. I love the color of this chair. He's taking the door with him. Well, then I'll have a breezy day. I won't have a door at all. And Jackie says, being new to the business, it's a learning curve for sure. It definitely is. And Rhonda says, I can't wait for you to come to Colorado in September. I know we're going to have so much fun in September. If anybody would want to join us for that workshop, Rhonda is hosting. She is also the Whimsical Chair here on Facebook. And she is in Castle Rock, Colorado. And we still have two spots left in that workshop. And that is September 12th through the, did I scratch my wood? Yeah, I scratched my leg up a little bit. 12th through the 14th of September this year. So it'll be a nice time of year to go to Colorado and join us. And actually there's somebody, and I can't think of the name right off the top of my head, Rhonda, but there's somebody out in your area who's a member who might join us one night for dinner, which will be fun. Hello, Kathy, thanks for joining us. Super important when tufting. You must be talking about the tucking tool. Yes, it definitely comes in handy when tufting. Bill's laughing. Hey, David Brown, how are you? David and I went to college together. We went to Hallmark Institute of Photography together a long time ago. And Bonnie says, haha, talks to me all the time, and you're always in my ears as well. I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing, Bonnie, but hey, Terry, thanks for joining us. Terry actually went to high school with me. And hello, Jeannie, thanks for joining. And Missy, hope you're doing well since I saw you in Louisiana not too long ago. All right, we have the seat done, ladies and gentlemen. Ta-da! So now our next move is the outside back. So there you go. And I will trim this all down later, but just for time's sake, we won't do that now. So the next piece of fabric that goes on is the piece of fabric that comes to the outside back of the chair. Typically, you're doing your insides of your furniture, but in this case, our outside has to be attached from the inside of the chair. And I did cut all my pieces. So this, and I can't really see the positioning on camera, so I will have to walk around, but this is our outside back fabric. Do I have it right side up? Yes, I do. And the way I can tell that, this fabric I did not think had a up right side and upside down, but it actually does, because we've got these little circles that have a blue heart in the center, and they're all headed in the same direction. So that was kind of my key for right side up, because everything else turns and goes every which way, but those do not. So what I'm going to do is kind of hold this on the back. I'll kind of turn so you guys can see it too. And I was playing around with the positioning earlier today, and what I was kind of trying to do was to get these two little heart pieces top and bottom. And I'm not necessarily trying to center them left to right. I'm really trying to make this look more even, because this is one of those prints that you could pretty much do anything with it. But I do notice in this particular repeat that there's a lot of heavy things clustered together and then a lot of small things, small pattern pieces. So I wanted to balance it out so that if you put it this way, you'd see I've got all heavy big medallions on this side and a bunch of little things over here. And I didn't really like that look. So then if I slide it over a little bit, then I've got some smaller medallions here, some smaller medallions here, and these three are kind of balanced out by the activity going on everywhere else. So that was kind of what I thought. So what do you guys think? Do you like that layout? Thumbs up if you think I've got it positioned well. And if not, give me a comment as to what you think. Oh, Bill's looking at me. He's nodding his head, so it must be okay. Like I said, I'm not trying to center those two yellows. I'm just trying to make it look balanced in the chair. So while I'm waiting, okay. So Deb from Georgia, hello, just bought new fabric for my dining room chairs. After I bought it, I thought, should I have kept them neutral instead of bringing out a color in my new rug in the den? Decisions. I know, picking fabric is really tough because you're committing to it for a long time. It's an expense and you don't want to be changing it and wishing you had chosen a different fabric. And Mary's telling you, Deb, have fun with color. And I agree with her 100%. Life is too short to live in a white room. You need to have lots of fun colors. All right, so before I lose my positioning, which I just did. Let me just tip this down and get a temporary staple in the top, so at least the top's held. Now I can go back to the bottom And again, I'm watching the grain too to make sure I've got it going straight. Okay, Bill, we still looking good?
Yeah, that's good.
Okay. There. So now I can stand back and look at it. Okay, I'm going to come back here beside you guys. I'm beside the camera. Yeah, I like that positioning. I think that looks good. And of course, I've got plenty of my pink in there. So, all right, so now we have to get it stapled the rest of the way around. Now, when you do the outside back, let me show you this one. And I don't remember what my intention was or the pattern on this one, but you can see, maybe if I get this in the right position, you can see. Turn. There we go. So you can see how the outside back looks when it's all attached. And then the in, so the, your support system goes over the top of that, your padding on that, and then your finished fabric. So for our support, for the next part, we'll be using the sagless that you've seen me use. And you could use jute webbing strips for this, but I just like the sagless because it's not quite as bulky. And sagless is a polypropylene material, and not all companies call it sagless. Where I purchase it from, that is what they call it. So you might find it called something different from your suppliers.
It's easy for us to get, and we use it all the time.
Yeah, we do use it instead of jute webbing 90% of the time. All right, so then you want to start working out, but you want to be careful and keep your fabric following the curve, which is not easy to do sometimes. You really do have to take your time on this, and just, again, what is the fabric going to do? It's going to tell me what it wants to do. If I can stop stepping on my hose. All right, you know what I think I'm going to do? I think I'm actually going to lay this on its back. And pump this pedestal up a little bit, and then we'll turn it so you can see better. Now you can see my chair's bottom. Oh, no, you can't because you're overhead. All right, so that is as high as this pedestal goes. I had posted a picture earlier and someone commented on how high the pedestal went. Well, that's the pedestal we used to have that ended up breaking, and I did like how high that one went. All right, so I'm just watching the curve, keeping everything straight. And at this point, you don't want to be yanking on your fabric. You want to be fairly gentle. How many of you have done these kind of picture back chairs before? Some of the antique chairs, like an Eastlake chair, are done similarly. Although a lot of times those, the outside back is done from the outside. Okay, I'm getting a little bit of slop right here, which means I gotta adjust that staple. I got one staple where to go right here that I need to move. When you have to adjust these, it definitely is take your time because you're at a point where, again, you get this almost stapled on and you could wreck this piece of fabric pretty easily. All right. I think that is gonna, I might have to remove one more. Yeah, I think that'll be it. Just once I get this one out, I think we are good. All right, so just double check before I fill that in. Everything's laying nice, the tension feels really good. One other thing you want to do is you want to run your hands along the back side of the chair to make sure you didn't come out where you weren't supposed to with your staples. So keeping your gun angled properly to avoid doing that. Couple more staples over here. All right, now I'm going to go ahead and trim this down a little bit. Then I'm going to fold it over and staple it again. This fabric is thin enough that I'm comfortable doing that. I'm not worried about having too much bulk. Also, if you have a fabric with a really loose weave, it's a good idea to do that. But if you're working with a thicker upholstery fabric that doesn't have a loose weave, you don't have to do that. What, Bill?
Turn sideways.
Turn sideways? Okay. There you go. All right, so I'm just trimming it down, leaving, I don't know, we'll see. What do I leave here? Half, 3/4 of an inch. You can always trim more off, but you can't put it back, so it's better to err on the side of too much excess. Now, also when you're doing this, if you have a fabric that the folded over part will show from the outside, you don't want to do this. Now, how many of you have ever, I think actually this weekend is it, how many of you have ever been to High Point, North Carolina, to like the market and stuff, Showtime? We're actually doing a, hopefully our first annual, we'll see if we do more, upholstery meetup, and some of you that are on here now I know are joining us for that in High Point, North Carolina this summer. And that is going to be, what is it, July 30th through August 1st, we're all going to be together. And I am so looking forward to that, because I mean, we interact with each other all the time online, but there's several of us that have never met in person. And Greenhouse Fabrics has agreed to do a luncheon and a little demonstration. They're actually going to give us a little hands-on task to do to learn about the different fabrics and give us a tour of their facility. I'm also working with a furniture frame company. I'm trying to hook up with them to do a tour and a discussion about the different furniture frames, and then I'm working on a couple other things. I don't know which one will happen yet. I'm just trying to find the right people to fit our group, but that's going to be a lot of fun. And we've gotten a room block rate for the Kim's Upholstery group at one of the hotels, which is nice. So it's just get yourself there, pay for your own room and food, and I'm out of staple guns, and join us for a fun time. Joanne, I think, was on here. She's going. I can't think of who else was on here that's going. Wait this second. Okay, so at this point, I don't need a ton of staples in this layer. Because our sagless is going over the top, and then you still get your final fabric going over the top. And I stopped talking while I'm stapling because I know you can't hear me anyway. We've also added, some of you out there may have seen them already. Actually, I think Bonnie has, because Bonnie's mentioned them in some of the discussions in the groups. We've got our new tips and techniques videos out there, and we've got a new full video tutorial. We've got invisible zipper tutorial, and that other channel back chair, which has the springs on the inside back, and the channels were done a little bit differently. So we've recently added those to our online offerings and our educational website. Okay, guys, what do you think? Maybe a couple more. So how many of you, when you upholster a piece of furniture, or when you take apart a piece of furniture, I should say, I am never putting as many staples back in as the last guy did. Why did they put down so many staples? And then you find yourself doing the exact same thing. All right, so let's stand it up and take a peek. Are we ready? Ta-da! And actually, I can see the layout from this side because the light shines through. But what do you guys think? I think I like it. Hey, Mikey, he likes it. Let's see, we've got some other people here. Hey, Beth Hodges, thanks for joining us. I haven't seen you in a long time. And we've got Deborah says hello. Hi, Deborah and Cynthia and Pat. Deborah says she loves the color. And she says, I'm going to move over here so I don't have to straddle the post. Where do you get the saglas? We get our saglas from Albany, Deborah. It's polypropylene fabric. So whatever your supplier calls it, if you tell them it's a polypropylene support system for furniture, they'll hopefully know what you're talking about. Let's see. Is that it? Nope, here's some more comments here. I am watching from Sweden on vacation. Oh, good for you. And hello, Alicia. Thanks for joining us. And Deborah says, I thought you would have needed to pull the saglas fairly tight, but I see you are not so much. I haven't put the saglas on yet, but no, we won't be pulling it really tight for this application. So Pat says, I did them before I found you. I'm not sure what you were referring to. I don't remember that far back in my head. Rhonda says, I've done several. They are my favorite chair to do. Oh, the channel backs maybe? Oh, the picture back chair. Sorry, picture back chairs we were talking about. Okay, now I'm clicking. Hello, Tony. Thanks for joining us. And Lynn Wilson. How close are those staples? The first set of staples were probably a quarter inch apart, and then the second layer of staples are probably a couple inches apart. There's not too many on the second layer. Sharon says hello. She was at the High Point thing, I'm assuming. Deb's got to go. Thanks, Deb, for watching. We'll see you again soon. Rhonda says, I just got sagless webbing from my supplier. That's true. It does come in a webbing format as well as a yardage format like we get it. Hello, Renee from Minnesota. Thanks for stopping in today. If this is your first time watching us on a Facebook Live, go ahead and give us a thumbs up. I know a lot of your names are familiar from previous shows, but some of you, the names sound new to me. So go ahead and give us a thumbs up if this is your first time here watching us. Let's see. Sobe says on YouTube, says, Deb here, do you all use piping on your dining chairs? I always do because I think it looks more pro. I think piping on everything finishes them off. I really think that's a personal preference. I agree with you. I do like the look of piping on most things. But when you're doing a real contemporary piece, sometimes it's nice without it as well. But I'm a piping girl myself. Or welting girl, whatever you call it. Welting, piping, cording. All those names seem to be interchangeable for the most part. And hello, Martin, all the way from the UK. How's Penny today? All right, so let's lay this baby back down and get the saglas. Although I gotta take the saglas out from under it before I lay it down. Okay, so Donna Cash has given me an addiction that I can't get rid of. Donna Cash, if you ever go to her workroom, which I'm gonna be there the middle of June for a workshop that I'm doing there this summer. She saves all these scraps of fabric, and she's gotten me so when I see scraps like this with these little motifs, I think, oh, there's a button instead of trash. So thank you, Donna, for giving me the addiction to keep all my scraps. Bill is going to love you immensely. How many of you have a hard time throwing away those fabric scraps? Sometimes they're too big to throw away, but sometimes it's the small ones. It's like, I could use it for a little decorative piece in a pillow, or I could add a button or make a detail. All right, so the same thing is going to be done with the saglas that we just did with the fabric. Again, we want it to stay taut against our base fabric, but hand tight for this is good enough for your backs. You don't have to use a stretcher to do the inside back area when you're doing saglas, but when you're on a seat of a chair and it's your support system, yes, you want to use a stretcher and get it really tight. The hand taut for this is good. Just pick up my pencil that I just dropped. And just move stuff before I knock it all on the floor. All right, and this, you want to be really careful again with the angle of your staples. I'm smoothing it in the back. I'm not out of staples, but my gun does keep misfiring, so it's either we don't have to pressure up on the air compressor, or because of me dropping it, I did something. Let's hope not. I think only one time has Bill had to make some repairs on a gun because I dropped it really hard one day, and what the heck did I break? I crushed something on the inside that you had to replace. Right. And I'm keeping it taut, but I'm making sure that I don't lift it off the fabric. That's feeling good. Alright, so now let's check and see if I got all my staples in the right place and nothing's sticking out where it's supposed, not supposed to be. Because you'll feel it. If you get the staples at the wrong angle, they'll pop out of your decorative wood on the back side and then you've got to repair, which is not the end of the world, but it's a pain. At this point, I am just filling in. Whoops. Okay, that staple hit a staple from underneath, which is bound to happen at this point, and kick back up. Now I remove them when that happens because I don't want to take the chance of them peeking through the fabric in the face when you're all done, even though you're putting double welt cord over this so it wouldn't poke out most likely, but I'd just rather be overly cautious and have a clean, neat finish. I mean, I find in anything in life, if you start taking shortcuts, it'll bite you in the butt at some point. Right, Bill?
Yeah, my butt's pretty sore.
Oh, okay, we do laugh together even when we're not doing blooper videos. And those blooper videos, we don't make those bloopers on purpose. They just kind of happen, and he records everything, which sometimes I forget. In fact, he put a couple ones out there on the last one. I'm like, really? Did you have to put that out there? But if you can't laugh at yourself, then you're a grumpy person. Okay, so, whoops, nope, one more here. So I think I've got at least as many staples as the last guy had in here already. So hello, Renee Nicole, and make Christmas ornaments with them. Make Christmas ornaments with the buttons, the fabric scraps, good idea. And Joanne is saying, what can I use instead of sagless? So is that what you were trying to signal me, Bill? You could use, what's it called? I always get this.
Panel board.
There's panel board and there's chipboard.
On that side. It's got glue all over the other side.
Yeah, so this is panel board. You could use panel board to do this instead of sagless, so you would cut it to fit in that area. And nest it in there, and it really would only be attached in a few places, but your fabric and everything would hold it together. Now these chairs did have, and I opted not to use them because I wanted it padded more, they did have these pieces. You said it was plywood. I was calling it Luon, but you said it's more like a plywood.
Yeah.
It's really, really thin, as you can see, and it's shaped to mimic, rather, the curve. Which camera are we on? This camera. There we go. It's shaped to mimic the curve of the chair. Now, I wanted to go with the sagless because I wanted to have a thicker padding, and this would allow me to make it as poofy as I wanted because of the way they attached it. Because what they did is they had this upholstered kind of like a slip seat. So it was just the fabric was attached to this. It literally had a piece of foam that was like an eighth of an inch thick in there. And then it had the cording attached to the backside. You can see all the staples on there, or maybe you can't. Had the cording attached to the backside, and then it set in there and it was held on with little finish nails that were hidden in the fabric. And it didn't allow me to go as poofy as I wanted using it this way. And I also liked the idea of the double welt cord, which I don't think would have looked good to try to attach it with those. So I did not use those and decided to use sagless. And let's trim this down. And again, we're gonna fold this over the same way we did the fabric. Kim. Get your scissors in there. That's that left hand, right hand thing again. So sometimes it feels awkward. I call it my upholstery yoga because you get in these funky positions. They're like yoga poses. Okay, so there is our sagless all trimmed. I'll save this for my Christmas ornaments. Sorry, Bill. More fabric scraps. And again, fold this back just like we did with the fabric.
Time to get a wood stove.
No wood stove. Bill likes wood stoves because he can just throw things in there and get rid of them. And we don't have a wood stove. Again, I'm reaching behind periodically to make sure my staples, because at this point I can't get my gun angled as drastically as I would like, because I've got all this resistance here. Well, if I go this way over here, now that I'm past the arm, I can. And think about all the staples I'm putting in this little guy. By the time we get our face fabric on there, we have a ton of staples. Now, nope, still not time for reload. And again, these staples are fairly close together on this part. Crystal says, when you go to Donna's workroom, find out how she organizes all of those scraps. That's a good question, Crystal. I have to check that. It's so funny because we were throwing those away last year when we had the slipcover class, and she's like, don't throw those away. Bonnie says, webbing and burlap. Burlap, maybe, Joanne. That's true. Yes, she could use jute webbing and burlap. You are right. Bill's pretty funny. Yes, he is, or he thinks he is. No, he is funny. And hello, Tamara, you're over here now. You were on YouTube a while ago. Sharon says, I love the bloopers and Bill's growl when you mention something like dropping your stapler off out loud. I know, if you could hear the two of us sometimes, people would be like, are they like fighting or what are they doing? It's like, no, we're just having fun. And then other times it's like, they're just really strange. But I'm gonna go ahead and finish this up, and it is the bottom of the hour already. And for those of you that are members of our online classes, again, we will be live with the Q&A this afternoon at 3 o'clock in your member portal. So you can go ahead and post your questions ahead of time or join us and bring your questions in as you come. And as always, we encourage you to come in live. So maybe some of you will join us in live there today instead of sitting behind the camera hiding. But thanks again, everybody, for joining us here. As always, go ahead and hit that share button even after the feed. People can watch the replay. And for those of you that are members, we will see you in about 90 minutes from now. And I'm going to go ahead and get this sagless finished on here. And next week, we'll pad and put the fabric on the inside back facing front.